This is Bloomberg Businessweek with Carol Masser and Tim Stenovec on Bloomberg Radio.
Well, artificial intelligence has been transforming the workplace. We know that, Jess. It's also been transforming the stock market. I mean, look at what NVIDIA has done so far this year. Plus, we got the likes of Microsoft and Alphabet higher as a result of people being bullish when it comes to AI. By the way, LinkedIn is estimating that the skills needed for jobs are expected to change by at least 65% by the year 2030. This says AI accelerates workplace change.
Wow.
Yeah, joining us is LinkedIn Chief Operating Officer Dan Shapiro, who joins us on Zoom from Mountain View, California. We like checking in with Dan every few months, particularly at the end of a year, because LinkedIn is out with some predictions about what 2024 is going to look like. Dan, good to have you back. How are you?
Good. It's great to be here.
Yeah, it's really good to have you with us. Hey, before we get to predictions, can you give us where we are in terms of jobs in the economy? Because the bond market and the equity market are certainly telling us one thing, and that's a soft landing is coming. What does the data at LinkedIn, which you have a plethora of, tell us?
Well, the labor market remains pretty tight, at least within the professional ranks on a global basis. And obviously, that varies quite a bit by sector and by industry. You've seen a number of tech companies, particularly private tech companies, pull back. But then if you go into sectors like healthcare or services, those businesses continue to grow. So it's been a pretty big mix. But I think perhaps one of the most interesting trends has been that people moving jobs and switching between companies has come down by quite a bit. So many companies are experiencing attrition at a historical low. Now, the interesting thing about attrition is that it's like water behind a dam. It always tends to pay off at some point. So I think it's pretty likely that sometime in the next 12 months, you'll see attrition or just movement of professionals between companies to start to come back up, and more people will open up and look at new job opportunities.
That's really interesting. It's coming on the back of what we saw in that latest JOLTS report that fell below 9 million. It had been pretty elevated, still is so. That's pretty interesting given that backdrop there. What do you think are some of the biggest concerns among job switchers at this point? Because we talked so much about when it comes to, even though inflation coming down though, but that wage growth still strong. So obviously you would think that's helpful for people who want to switch jobs. What does the wage picture tell us?
Well, I think when the future is uncertain, you hold on to your chair. You want to, you know, make sure you have stability in your life when it feels like the world around you is a little more chaotic. And so I don't think it's surprising that as the economic backdrop has been a little bit less certain, a little more opaque, that people have tried to really stay true to the job that they already have. But as people get more confident in the future, as the economy starts to pick back up, as the soft landing perhaps comes into clearer view, I think people will open up again.
Hey, let's talk a little bit about wage pressure, because when you say that the market is tight, at least for the professional ranks, it makes me think about wage pressure. And again, going back to the macroeconomic conditions out there and what exactly the Fed chair is trying to do with telegraphing rate cuts in the next year. Do you see kind of what the Fed sees and what the data tell us at LinkedIn, that even though professional ranks, it's still very competitive, are we still seeing the wage pressures? Like, are potential employees still in the driver's seat, Dan?
I don't have access to the wage data that the Fed does, but what I can tell you is that it is not the environment that it was just a few short years ago. A few years ago, you saw some incredible raises that people were getting when they jumped from company to company. And that's just not happening at the same rate that it was before, at least within professional ranks. Now, I'm sure that there are certain disciplines where that might be happening. And if we get into AI in a second, you're definitely seeing that within AI technologies, where there are people that are deeply skilled in large language models and prompt engineering and data infrastructure. And there's going to be an insatiable appetite for that kind of talent all over the labor market. But more broadly, I think it's a different environment than it was just a few years ago.
So we're beginning to see even more so some of those lagged effects from those Fed hikes, Dan, even though we're waiting on potentially more next year.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see where it all nets out. I was following the news just like everyone to see what the recent releases are, and it'll be interesting to see as there's more predictability about what the Fed's doing and perhaps a rate decrease if that changes hiring plans.
So Dan, let's get to AI and talk about some of the effects that AI is having on jobs. I mean, you're a great guy to talk to, but we should note that I did mention Microsoft. Microsoft is, of course, the parent company of LinkedIn, and Microsoft is certainly going all in on AI. At LinkedIn, are you guys getting to use an AI tools that Microsoft is developing? Kind of explain the relationship that you have with the parent company.
Absolutely. As you mentioned, we're a business unit within Microsoft more broadly, and I think that this is a moment where that's been wonderful for our LinkedIn's members and customers. Before the world saw ChatGPT in November of 2022, we got to see some of the new large language models that were coming out of the OpenAI relationship, and it absolutely struck us just like it struck the whole world at large. And as a result of that, we've had an opportunity to embed many of those capabilities into a whole variety of products, helping job seekers find jobs, helping recruiters engage with candidates, helping salespeople prepare for meetings by doing research on companies, helping marketers build campaigns. I mean, what's sort of remarkable about this technology is how ubiquitously applicable it is, and also how easily it can be integrated into existing tools that people are already using in their daily lives. So it's absolutely permeated our product portfolio. And my big prediction for 2024 is that while last year was very much about learning about what this new technology could do, this is going to be the year where companies and individuals start to use AI to truly differentiate themselves relative to the competition.
What industries do you expect to see stronger job growth due to the adoption of AI versus those that won't?
Well, I think every AI, we've said in the last decade that every company is becoming a tech company of sorts, whether you're in retail or services or manufacturing. I think we're going to find the same thing with AI. Every company is going to be forced to figure out how their strategy is going to be shaped by AI and how their team is going to change how they work as a result of AI. One of the things we say at LinkedIn is that AI is going to impact every job and every team. And I think 2024 is going to be the year where we figure out where that really comes to bear in different industries.
So we have about a minute and a half with you right now, and then we're going to come back for more after we do some news, Dan. But what do we have to do as professionals to be prepared for the AI revolution?
Well, let's talk about it at two levels. As an individual, my advice to everyone is just get started. Download some of the apps, play with the technology, maybe use it for personal use, use it for some professional use. Find one thing that you find useful. Because my experience is that some people, they can feel paralyzed. It feels like this new thing. They're not sure how to make use of it. And it feels like it can change in so many ways. But if you can find one habit to deploy on a daily basis, then you can start to learn how this technology can make a difference for you, and then you can figure out how to embed it in a broader range of things in your life. I also think for job seekers, this is going to be a skill that's expected by employers. I was speaking with a head of recruiting at a large company in Chicago recently, and one of the things that she said is that it's one of the primary factors that they're starting to use in their hiring processes. Are you comfortable using some of this new AI technology? Because they want talent on their team that's comfortable with it. And you're going to start to see a mix of people that are both comfortable and then others that are reluctant.
Hey, Dan, sit tight because we're going to do some news and come back and chat more about what's going on at LinkedIn and also about how we can prepare for AI and hopefully not AI taking my job anytime soon. That's Dan Shapiro. He's the COO of LinkedIn. We're going to be back with him in just a few minutes.
Back with us, of course, is LinkedIn Chief Operating Officer Dan Shapiro on Zoom from Mountain View, California, continuing our discussion on how AI is evolving in the workplace landscape and what's ahead for the job market in 2024. We last left off talking about the recruiting process, Dan, and especially when it comes to AI being a hot topic for recruiters as well as job seekers. I'm curious your view now that we're getting past the pandemic, because work from home was such a hot topic at that point, and so many employees were doing that. What does that look like now when it comes to negotiating through the job process?
Well, it's been a dynamic situation. I think when the pandemic happened, you saw a lot of companies start to embrace more flexibility. You saw a lot of opening of remote roles. And as there was a time period just a few years ago where 20% of the job openings on LinkedIn were remote. But as we've gotten past the pandemic phase and things have become more endemic, you've seen remote openings come down in some industries below 10%. And so you start to see that remote roles are becoming less available on average. But there is still a lot of discussion about flexibility, and that's a place where each company defines flexibility a little bit differently. So it really varies company to company and industry to industry.
So what about when it comes to actual like long-term hybrid work and flexibility here? This is something that I know our colleagues and certainly our listeners and viewers are really interested in. I've seen, and from what I've observed anecdotally, and from also speaking to people who have the data here, that it does certainly feel like we're back to this, you know, not necessarily everyone's in the office 5 days a week, but we're gone are the days of like 2 or 3 days a week in the office. I mean, we're in the office 4 days a week at a
That's
minimum, it
right.
seems like. And I'm not even speaking for Bloomberg. I'm speaking like me. Like I have to be here every day because of what I do. But it does seem like everybody I talk to in New York City, this is the norm rather than the exception. What are you seeing in terms of jobs that are advertised on LinkedIn and sort of the experience of your members?
It's interesting how geographically specific this trend is. So, if you're in New York, if you're in Europe, if you're in Asia Pacific, you see that things in many places have gotten back a little bit closer to where they were pre-pandemic, where people are in the office, you know, 4 and in some cases 5 days a week. I think you do see environments where affordance of flexibility has definitely gone up. There's a greater understanding of people coming in or leaving at certain hours or needing to work home and life around each other a little bit more. On the West Coast, the environment's a little bit differently. You see more companies embracing less frequent office participation, and it really varies by the industry you're in. So, you know, it's one of the things that I encourage anyone that's going through a job seeking process is just to make sure you understand what's important to you and understand the norms that exist at the company. And interestingly enough, sometimes the norms that are written down on paper are not the norms that are practiced. And so it's always good to not just talk to the HR team, but talk to some people on the team that you're working with to
That's a good
understand how
point.
teams really operate.
So, who do you think has the upper hand now, job seekers or employers?
Oh, well, it's a much more balanced market. If 2 years ago I would have said job seekers were
Right.
in the driving seat by and large, it's a much more balanced situation. Now, you know, we were talking about AI before. If you have AI skills and you are in such demand by employers, then you are very much in the driver's seat, and you're seeing companies pay very substantial sums to find AI talent. I think that's going to persist, if not get worse, as we get into 2024. But I think in lots of other places, it's much more balanced.
Can you talk to us about what AI skills particularly are and how do you acquire them?
Absolutely. So I think there's two ways to talk about AI skills. I think the first is in the broadest sense. If you are in sales, if you are in marketing, if you're in engineering, if you're in accounting, if you're in recruiting, your employer is going to want you to be comfortable with AI such that they can bring it into your day-to-day process. And so I encourage every job seeker to use AI in some way such that you can bring a personal story into your interview about how you've AI, used AI to use any number of tasks, and having an understanding of how that might help you be more productive as an employee. So it's not that you're learning AI as a technical skill, but you're learning how to apply it to your day-to-day interactions. I think every employer is going to be looking for people with this kind of capability. And then beyond that, you get into much more technical realms, and you're talking about, do you have understanding of machine learning? Do you have an understanding of large language models, particular kinds of neural networks? And you're seeing an influx of people from technical backgrounds learning these kinds of AI-specific technical skills to have access to some of these incredible opportunities that are now starting to emerge.
Hey Dan, I want to shift gears and just end sort of about LinkedIn's business because as COO, you have a seat right, a front row seat there. colleague Sarah Fryer, who covers, who is the big tech team leader for Bloomberg News, wrote an article back in August about how LinkedIn has been gaining engagement as Twitter, now known as X, and Facebook face stagnation. And she shared this stat that LinkedIn shared, that in the spring of this year, users shared 41% more content on LinkedIn than they did in the same period in 2021. Can you give us an update about engagement on the platform and what you're seeing in the second half of 2023?
And well, more people are using LinkedIn every day for a wider range of things. We crossed 1 billion members on the platform recently, which is amazing. I joined the company as an employee back in 2008. We had less than 20 million members. Wow. So crossing 1 billion is an incredible milestone. And, you know, whereas years ago, LinkedIn was a place to create a profile, maybe build connections. Increasingly, it's become a place to share and consume professional knowledge. So we see people giving updates on their industries. The conversations around AI are up over 70% year on year. So we see a lot of people understanding best practices of applying AI in their industry. And then, you know, as you might expect in for companies or people that have been displaced from a job perspective in the last year, you see people finding jobs on LinkedIn, which is one of our core use cases. So engagement this year has been fantastic, and we're really excited to chart our path to the next 1 billion professionals.
Hey, Dan, happy holidays. It's always nice to check in with you. Really appreciate you joining us on Bloomberg Business Week this afternoon. That's LinkedIn Chief Operating Officer Dan Shapiro. If you were watching, you saw him joining us on Zoom from Mountain View, California. Jess, it's going to be a year filled with AI. That's a prediction that I certainly have. You're listening and watching Bloomberg Business Week.